Welcome back, everybody. As we continue to talk about some basic concepts in statistics, this time let's focus on talking about some different methods for obtaining random samples. The beauty of random samples is that they're likely to be representative of the population. Remember, when I say that something is representative of the population, it means that that sample has essentially the same characteristics as the population. It's much easier to measure a small sample, and if that sample represents the population, we can learn about the population from the sample. That said, we know that sampling error does indeed exist, and what that means is that our sample statistics are unlikely to match our population parameters perfectly. But if our sample statistics come from random samples, we should be able to estimate population parameters from those sample statistics pretty accurately. So I think we might have seen this example before, but if you look at an entire population of 1,000 college students, whatever characteristics describe that population are known as population parameters. So like the average age of all of those students would equal 21.3 years old. That is the correct answer for the entire population. That is a population parameter. But we know that some populations are simply too large to measure. So we can select a random sample from that population, and then from that random sample, compute some sample statistics. In this particular sample, we see that the average age is 19.8 years old. That's not exactly equal to 21.3 simply because of sampling error. So our sample statistics aren't going to be perfect, but sampling will provide us with a method of learning about populations without measuring the entire population. For right now, what I really want to do is talk about how can we obtain a random sample. In other words, what are some common methods that we can use to obtain random samples? Let's start by talking about a relatively old school procedure. And these couple procedures that I'm going to talk about next work out relatively well when a population isn't too large. So one thing we could do if the population isn't too large is take everybody's name from that population. In all these examples, let's just assume that we're dealing with people in the population. Take every single person's name and write each one of those names on a separate piece of paper. You can then take all of those little pieces of paper, put them into a hat or a box or something else, mix them up real good, and then just start randomly selecting names from that hat. That random selection process will result in a random representative sample. So I gave it a little frowny face as an evaluation, just because that's the type of thing we don't really do too much anymore. We have better methods nowadays, but that's legit. That would give you a random representative sample. Let's talk about a couple other methods that are much more commonly used nowadays. For example, we could use a table of random numbers. This is still relatively low tech, but it works out pretty well. You'll see in statistics books, there's always some table of random numbers. They look a lot like this, what you see right here. You can find tables of random numbers online. There are entire books of random numbers. So the question is, how do we use a table of random numbers to select a random sample? Don't forget what the goal is here. We want to give every single person in the population an equal opportunity of being selected for our sample. So let's go through an example using this table that we see right in front of us. We'll keep the example relatively small scale just so we can get through it relatively quickly. Imagine that we have a class of 35 students, and for whatever reason, we can't measure all those 35 students because there's just too many, and we want to select a random sample of 5 students. So here's how we can use the table of random numbers. We're going to give every single one of those students a unique number, and because we have 35 people overall, 35 is a 2-digit number. I'm going to assign every single student a 2-digit number. So the very first student in line has number 01, the next student 02, the next student 03, all the way until we get student number 35. After every one of those 35 students has been assigned a 2-digit number, I'm now going to find a random place to start in this table of random numbers. And let's say I start right there where you see that number 2. Starting at that point, I'm going to see what's the next 2-digit number. And you can see the next 2-digit number is 27. And what that means is that student number 27 you've just been selected to be a part of this sample. And then we're going to continue reading the numbers to the right until we find another two-digit number somewhere between 101 and 35. The next two-digit number that I see is 56, and we don't have a student numbered 56, so we move on. The next two-digit number that I see is 99. We don't have a student 99, so I move on. The next two-digit number that I see is 01. We do have a student 01. Student number 01, you've just been selected for our sample. Well, we need 5 students for our sample in total, so I keep going. What's the next two-digit number? 84. We don't have that. What's the next two-digit number? 02. We do have that. Student number 02, you've just been selected to be in our sample. We now have 3 students in our sample. What's next? Student number 33, you've been selected to be in our sample. We now have 4 students in our sample. What's the next number we see? 83. We don't have that. Next number is 93. And the next two-digit number is 18. Student number 18, you're the final person to be selected in our sample of 5 students. So I guess that's a relatively low-tech procedure for picking a random sample as well, but it works pretty well. Let me quickly show you a couple methods that I think are much more fun, using some better technology. First, we'll open up SPSS. This is an SPSS data window, and what I did was create a variable called student, and I listed 35 students, because in the example we've been talking about, we've got 35 students, and we want to randomly select 5 of them. SPSS can do this really easily. If I go to the data menu, I can go to where it says select cases, and then right over here it says random sample of cases. If I click that and then click on sample, I can say I want to pick exactly 5 cases from the first 35, and then say continue, and then say okay. Here we are back at the data window. SPSS has created a filter. Everywhere that you see a 1, that student has been selected, and everywhere you see a 0, those students have been crossed out. And you can see SPSS has automatically selected 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 students from the 35. So SPSS provides a really easy method to select a random sample. Let's check out another technique. Let's use Excel. So here's Excel. Excel and SPSS look a lot alike. So in Excel, we can use functions to randomly select numbers. And there's a function called randbetween, and it will randomly pick a number between some low value and a high value. Let me show you how to use that function. All Excel functions begin by typing in an equal sign. I'm going to start typing in that function name, randbetween. Once I've got that function name typed in, I need to open up a parenthesis. Excel is asking me now, what's the bottom number? What's the lowest number you want to select from? We're going to put in a 1, then I put a comma. Now Excel is saying, what's the highest number you want to select from? 35. Because in our example, we have 35 students, and we want to randomly select 5 of those 35. So now all I need to do is hit enter. I want that exact same function used 5 times over so that we can select 5 people. So I'm simply going to select that cell and copy it down 5 times. Now Excel will update the entire worksheet when I lift up my mouse key, and that means that 10 is going to be replaced by another number. We're going to take those 5 numbers that Excel creates, and those are going to represent the 5 students we select. And there we go. So we would select student number 6, student number 16, 25, 23, and 27. Randomly. So now we have a good random sample selected. Sometimes the populations that we're dealing with are extremely large. And when that's the case, sometimes researchers use other methods. For example, they might use random mailings. Now, using a mailing in the US mail is becoming old school as well. But this same general technique can apply to email mailings or other types of mailings as well. So let me show you what I'm talking about. Let's come back to Excel for a moment. We saw how we could use an Excel function to randomly select some numbers representing students in our class. We could also use Excel to pick other numbers, for example, zip codes for a random mailing. Look at this sheet right here. Let's just say that a researcher already found this zip code, 43701, which is Zanesville. And they decided that Zanesville is going to get at least a few of these random mailings. Well, you probably know that the post office uses a zip code with four extra numbers on it. So to see the specific areas where we plan to send these random mailings, we can use Excel to randomly select those four extra digits. I'll use the same Excel function that we used before to randomly select a four-digit number. We're going to begin with an equal sign and then type in that command name, rand between. I'm going to open up my parentheses. Excel is asking me now for the lowest four-digit number possible. I'll put in 0000, put a comma. What's the highest four-digit number I want it to select from? 9999. Close my parentheses, hit enter, and there it randomly selected a four-digit number. So now we have a zip code plus four digits, and we could randomly mail our questionnaire, our survey, whatever it is, to that area. If we wanted to have more options, we could select that and copy it down. So that's one way we could use Excel to randomly select some zip codes for a random mailing. Instead of connecting with a random sample via the mail, some researchers want to connect with a random sample via the telephone. And in that case, they might use random digit dialing. In general, everybody who has a phone number would have an equal opportunity of being selected for one of these studies. All that we would need to do is randomly select some phone numbers that we would actually want to call. So let's go back to Excel and I'll show you how we could do that. We'll use a similar procedure that we used for random mailings. I'm going to click on this sheet right here. It's set up for random digit dialing. Let's just assume right now that the researchers decided they were going to randomly call at least some phone numbers that were in the Dresden area. And in Dresden, the area code is 740 and the exchange is 754 for most home-based phone numbers. What we would need is four more digits to round out that phone number and determine exactly who to call. So let's use that rand between command again. We can type in equals rand between, open up the parentheses, type in the smallest four-digit number that we want, 0000. Type in the largest four-digit number that we could use, 9999. And now Excel is going to randomly select a four-digit number between those two. So I hit enter. Now, of course, we're going to need several numbers to select from, so I can copy that all the way down. So again, this is just one method that we could use to obtain some random telephone numbers that we could then call when using random digit dialing. There are times when researchers collect data from a sample, and then later on they realize that their sample doesn't match the population as well as they'd like it to. In those situations, they can weight the data so that the final results are based on characteristics that do indeed resemble the population. Let me give you a quick example. Imagine political polling data. When researchers call potential voters and they ask them who they plan to vote for in an upcoming election, not everybody complies. Not everybody answers their questions. So in the end, the people who responded won't necessarily match the characteristics of the people in the population. So for instance, maybe the researchers will find that 50% of their respondents are women, and that sounds pretty good so far. But historically, they might realize that 55% of the voters are women. In these situations, when the researchers analyze the results, they can give that 50% of respondents a little bit more weight so that in the final results, they actually represent 55% of the total. You'll better understand what I mean by that when later on we discuss computing weighted means. All right, I think that's enough for now. I hope you found this discussion interesting. I'll see you in the next video. In the meantime, be safe.